This is Bink. This is Behind the Beats.
How'd you get started into production?
I kind of fell into it, you know. Coming from a family with a serious, you know, singing background, so I used to play drums in church when I was 8 until I was probably about 14, and just loved music. My father was a serious record buyer, like weekly record buyer type of guy, and just listening to him blast, you know, Spinners, Temptations, Crusaders, you know, you name it, like just listening to that, Al Green, just, you know, it was just in me. And then my mother loved gospel, so just getting the soul and the gospel both fed to me from both ends, it just gave me a love, you know, for music automatically. But I ended up doing the whole b-boy thing, you know, break dancing, started DJing. So just from DJing, it just evolved into doing music. But it was never like a dream of mine to be a producer. Like that's not how I came up. I wanted to get a job at the shipyard or the railroad, like a regular, you know, guy that you know in your neighborhood. Your father, like somebody working at the railroad, they got a pretty decent job, you know, pretty decent house, nice car. So that's all I was aspiring to do in life, for real. And just something hit me one day and just said, yo, I'm gonna try this music thing.
So tell us the story of how you hooked up with Teddy Riley for the Black Street.
I was at the studio called Triple Play in Virginia Beach. A couple of guys I knew, you know, was running it. This guy named Jody and a couple other guys, and like Titus. Anyway, they had like a barbershop at the bottom, car wash in the back, studio upstairs. So I was in the studio with my man Chance the Rapper, and not the new one. Back in the day, my man from here from Virginia, name was Chance. But we were up there banging out, and he was downstairs getting a haircut, just so happened. And he came up and asked me to play some more stuff. So I just started, you know, I had the ASR-10 at the time, so I started just loading in discs, just playing a bunch of stuff for him, trying to strike some small talk in between discs, you know what I'm saying? It'll take a little while for that shit to load up. So I started, you know, playing stuff, and I played that the bar sample, and the rest was history.
Was it that tempo, or was it sped up for like an MC? Or was it the same tempo?
It's the same tempo.
Okay.
But we just reprogrammed it on what he was working on. I think he was probably doing digital performer back then.
You know what I'm saying? Wow, okay.
You know, so we redid it. You know, went through and picked some drums up, you know, out of his drum catalog and put it back together. And he added all types of stuff and made it a big situation, you know what I'm saying? Way bigger than what I could have, you know what I'm saying? I learned a lot from that, you know, from that situation.
Who or what inspired you to produce coming up in the game?
Like I say, I was really into the whole culture of the whole b-boy. Anything had anything to do with b-boy, and I was just so about it. Like, you know, I love that whole beat street breaking, you know, vibe. It was just dope to me, you know what I'm saying? I was just very intrigued by it, so... You know, a lot of guys right here, you know, was into it, you know, real heavy too, because as you know, back in the 80s, late 80s, early 90s, like, the drug trade from New York migrated down here in a major way, so it was a serious New York influence down here at that time, so you were seeing the culture that they were bringing down, and the mixtapes they were bringing down, the Red Alert, Chill Out tapes, and all that type of stuff back then. It was just dope to me, and I was just really intrigued by it, so... That's what made me want to start producing, just listening to Run DMC and Tila Rock and, you know, all these old school, you know, people from back then. So it just really made me want to do it.
Okay. If you had the chance to produce a whole album for an artist.
Right.
Like be locked in the studio for a month, who would it be?
Dre 3000.
Why?
Because... there's no ceiling to what we can do. You know, it's a wide range of music and just a different variety of ways I can approach him musically, and that he will understand. And that's not a given. When you work with a lot of artists, they're pretty much one-dimensional. where you know they just do what they're good at and not really good at venturing off into other things. But Dre 3000 is the epitome to me of a real artist. It's a well-rounded guy that can, you know, can do damn any type of genre of music.
How did the Jay-Z situation come about?
Actually, the manager that I had at the time hooked me up to try and score for the Hard Knock Life tour, for the intro of the show. They needed, you know, it needed for that to be scored. So he talked them into giving me a chance to, you know, try to do that. So they booked me some time at Enterprise Studios in L.A. at the time. And I remember sampling Conan the Barbarian from the movie. I sampled some, you know, some from that scene. I knew it was real big, had like the big strings, all type of stuff in the horns. And I used that, and they loved it. And it ended up being on Benny Siegel's album, which was Ride For My Niggas. That was the beat from the intro for the Hard Knock Life tour.
So it seems like almost that you were a producer for, you might have produced for everybody on Rockefeller, almost.
Yeah, minus Chris John. But other than that, I pretty much did everybody at that time, in that window. Because, you know, as I left, you know, M.O.P. came over and a few other people came over as I kind of stepped away.
Like, looking through your discography, like, you've done, like, you damn near did the whole A-plus album.
Yeah. Shout out to A-plus. That was Parkside Gardens, I think the name of the album was. But, yeah, it was a good experience. That was a relationship I had with Kadar Massenberg at the time, which is, you know, his whole genius was with the Erykah Badu situation, the whole neo-soul movement. That was his thing. And he trusted me enough, you know, back then to put A-plus in my hands. And we knocked it out. It was a real dope experience. We worked at Unique Studios, I remember, for that whole album, I think we did. And it was dope. You know, A-plus was real good kid. And Cannabis was writing with him at the time as well. Cheeks wrote some joints for him. Like I said, he was a kid at the time, man. Like, was very, you know, real young, like a little, like maybe like 13, 14 or something like that. And, you know, you don't really, nobody really gets a chance to experience that life that early. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's not a lot of Shaheems and A-pluses and, you know what I mean? Like, ABC, you right. know, walking around here. Like, that's a definite blessing to catch it so early.
So was that your first time meeting Mr. Cheeks?
Oh, no. Me and Mr. Cheeks, we go back to Virginia. Actually, Cheeks was down here, you know, running around Pleasant Park, you know what I'm saying? And he at the time, he was working with Buck and L. And Buck and L had a company called Butt Naked at the time that was running side by side with Puffy and Bad Boy. And Butt Naked was supposed to put Cheeks out. But, you know, Buck and L had some issues that, you know, kind of caught up with them before they could actually, you know, put Cheeks out or whatever. So Cheeks ended up signing to, I think at the time, Uptown. The first one was at Uptown Records, you know, he signed with them. And we kind of got cool down here in Virginia, just, you know, working at my house, doing beats or whatever. And we hit it off real good. It was real good, you know, real cool guy, man. We had a real good friendship, you know what I'm saying? So from that, you know, when he finally went back to New York, you know, I was here. I didn't know he was really gone. And I was watching New York Undercover one night, and I remember hearing Lifestyle of the Rich and Shameless in the back. But I had never heard the song before, but I knew Cheeks' voice. I just remember being so excited, you know what I'm saying, for him. You know, it was almost like I made it, you know what I'm saying? Because, like, I had worked so close with somebody that actually finally achieved that goal that we were trying to achieve. So it was dope.
Talk about the sessions for Lights, Camera, Action, because that was a big song for Cheeks.
Yeah.
Like, how'd you even, like, think of to even use that sample?
I mean, I had that idea already kind of done because I had a group signed to Elektra at the time by the name of Non Brigade from Philly. And that track was actually one of the singles that we had for my group. We had Eve on the record with him at the time. And the other single was All I Need, that's ended up going on Jay's Blueprint album. Those were the two singles that I had for my group at that time. But, you know, one of my main star dudes in the group was murdered like the month we were mixing. And we, the project never came out, you know, Q Don. And so I never had a chance to put that out, but so I was just holding that. And Gene Riggins was mentoring me at the time at Universal Records, and she played me Cheeks' album and asked me what I thought, and I just really felt like a party record was missing. And I had to, you know, I had the perfect one for him. Just send me to wherever he is, you know, and I knock it out. So she was like really stressing about, you know, the budget was, you know, depleted and all that, and I was just like, a budget is not even really, in, you know, important to me, because me and Cheeks are something different. You know what I'm saying? Cheeks looked out for me. If it wasn't for Cheeks, I wouldn't be in the music game. Like, he allowed me to live on his floor for 2 years. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, with that being said, me knowing that, I'm like, I don't really care about a budget. I'm going to give my man the record because he needed it. And we worked the rest out later, whatever, you know. So, and that's what we did. They sent me to Miami. I came back, and then, you know, it was just, it was a good situation. It was a real good feeling to bring that back to the.
For the sessions for Jay, were you guys actually together in the studio to do Blueprint?
I mean, a couple of times we were, you know what I'm saying? But as far as being with him while he was writing his verses, no. Only time I was there was for probably the You, Me, Him, and Her record for Dynasty album. He heard that, and you know, he went right in on that the day of, like right there on the spot. He just, well, you know, Jay doesn't write anything down anyway, so he just, you know, walks around and just, you know, mumbles to himself, and you know, you hear him like woo to himself, like he's killing himself while he writing, you know, saying type shit. So, you know, yeah. So just watching him do that and take an interest in my music that day, it was definitely a, you know, a great feeling.
Going back to Lights, Camera, Action, whose idea was it to do a remix for it?
That was mine.
With obviously you had a relationship with Missy, Petey Pablo as well.
Yeah, Petey Pablo. You know, because Petey was signed to Timbaland. You know, which, you know, Timbaland's from here too. But I had met Petey on, you know, separate occasions, and we kind of hit it off too. And I knew he would understand what that beat was as well. I actually stepped to Nelly too early. But, you know, Nelly tried to cut my head off for the price, so we couldn't use Nelly. But I definitely had Nelly in mind too, because just the whole Nelly St. Lunatics movement was like a spinoff of Lost Boys. You know, when you look at the whole situation, like it damn near identical. You know.
Is there an artist that you have worked with that you thought was just okay, but surprised you, like when they finished a song?
The crazy thing, I was the first person to actually use Rihanna on a record, and that was a record I did for Memphis Bleek a while back, and she sung the hook for. I mean, I would never know that she would be the person she is today, you know, even though she was talented then, but I would never guess that she would be, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
What she is right now, you know, she's real cool. Now, you know, we didn't talk too much that day in the session, but she's real cool about it. Came and knocked it right out. And now look at her.
Yeah, megastar.
Mega.
Hey, you seem like every time that someone puts out an album and they have a Bink track, your track sticks out from everybody else's. Like, you seem to have a good relationship with Freeway. Like, you've given Freeway some heaters. Like, the We Remember.
Yeah.
That, I was listening to that on the way down here, and that beat is bananas.
And that was the two-track.
That was the two-track?
Yeah, Knuckleheads didn't give me a chance to mix the record. But that's a whole nother conversation. We're going to let that go. But, yeah, that's why it sounds so muddy. That's why When They Remember sounds so muddy. I wish I could get the vocals for that and redo another mix on that, because I actually had the horns redone and all types of stuff live and didn't even get to use it.
Your two track sounds better than some people's whole mixes, for real.
Nah, the two track was horrible to me, but you know, nobody could tell, so we just let it rock.
Right. Alright, let's talk about your production process. Like, do you start off with the sample and then add drums? Do you start off with drums? Because your drums knock. Like, I don't know if you make your drums louder on top of the mix on purpose, but that's what it seems like.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard louder, but I don't think there's no real process. It's just however it comes to you. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't really say I do everything the same way. You know what I'm saying? It's like, I may be here and hear a bass line, or, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's times where I may start with a drum track and I just make a straight drum track, but by the time I finish, it's a whole nother set of drums and a whole nother pattern. You know what I'm saying? It's like how I'm vibing, it changes according to how I'm vibing with it. With whatever idea that I'm working with, whether it's something from my head or my actual loop or something, or chop.
Now, your sound, well, not your sound changed, but your percussion changed, what, around 2003? Was that when you switched from the ASR to something else?
No, I switched from the ASR, man, early. Like, I didn't even do, like, I never set up, like, not use the ASR altogether. Like, I used to sample, you know, my guitars and stuff through the ASR 10 for, you know, for a long time, or anything through the ASR 10, but I stopped programming on it, like, years ago. You know, all the A-plus stuff was on the MP, you know what I'm saying? Lost Boys stuff was on the ASR 10. So right after the Lost Boys is when I stopped using the ASR 10 solely as my sequence and everything, and started using the MP and just MIDI the ASR 10 that would call up, you know, other sounds out of it, like drums that I already had, you know what I'm saying, on the ASR 10.
Now, does the drummer background come in handy when programming the drums?
I mean, yeah, because, you know, a lot of times people program things that are not physically possible. So it's just, you know.
So you program it to sound like it's a real drummer. Like a drummer could actually do that.
Yeah, probably. But, you know, of course they got, you know, people now, 3 and 4 drummers performing at one time, you know what I'm saying? So, okay, cool. But at the same time, it's just like, you know, you hear people who try to emulate that type of feel, and it's just, stuff is just all over the place. You know, it just doesn't make sense. It's just, you know what I'm saying, like a whole bunch of crash cymbals and a whole bunch of hi-hats just splashing all over the place, but not really making sense. But you wouldn't know that if you don't play drums, you know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah. Has anybody that you sample come after you for sample, for, or every?
No. Okay. Not really, no. Plus, you know, that's actually not really my,
yeah,
my fight anyway. Like, right, you know, I tell them the sample is there.
It's up to them to clear it.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. It doesn't fall on me.
So what advice would you give to a sampling producer who's doing beats and, you know, selling beats to artists with a sample in it? Like, what's your advice to them?
Make them split the sample with you. So if they do clear it, you know, and the sample take 50%, make them eat the other half, because they know the sample is in it. You dig what I'm saying? The only person that I can see you taking that fall for is, you know, some established artist, or somebody's in the same place that you in, trying to get on just like you, or a little bit over you. You know what I'm saying? Like, nah, don't let them make you take the whole fall for the sample. Make them split it with you.
Okay. You did some stuff with Tamia and Coco.
Yeah.
Now, how did the R&B stuff come about?
The Tamia thing came through Missy, you know, from working with Missy at the time. And I was I was producing with another producer by the name of, God dang it. I'm mad as hell right now because, no, he was a real Bryson, real good kid, you know, but he passed really early in his career. And he played keys for me, and we produced it actually together. The To Me and Stuff Were Missing. So it was dope. But the Coco thing came from, I met my homeboy to this day, Brian, you know what I'm saying? Produce all this stuff. Brian Cox, you know what I'm saying? So he flew me out to Minneapolis, you know, where nobody's at but him and his piano and Prince. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you know I'm saying Lake Minnetonka. But I went out there with him, and I had played him some. I had back on a DAT back then. I had this idea, this drum and harp, bass idea that I had, and I gave it to him, and he just really just put pretty colors all over it, and, you know, and made it sound, you know, appropriate for Coco, and it was just dope. But the main meat potatoes of that record was what I gave him. But the bridge and stuff that he put around it just really made it make, you know, put it all together.
Do you sample your drums, or do you sample yourself playing? Because I see you have drums in the studio.
I mean, both. It just depends on what the situation called for. You know what I'm saying? But I definitely go in there and knock something out and play it myself right quick and sample it later, or just play live top to bottom. And when they remember, I just play live from top to bottom. So
really?
Yeah.
Wow, okay. What's up with this project that you were supposed to have with Skills?
Skills will be here tomorrow, actually. And we are.
Damn, we here a day early.
Yeah, we're finishing up to, some things on tomorrow. But yeah, it's real. We're going to do it long overdue. Just want to do something with two people from here, actually. You know, put a project together and put it out.
Have you done anything with the clips before?
Nah. Some on Pusha's last mixtape. Okay.
How did the Rick Ross situation come about?
I mean, I've been knowing Ross before Ross was Ross. You know what I'm saying?
Hanging out in Miami with Cheeks?
Not at all. I was working with Angie Martinez, you know, years ago, and we hired him to do the writing for Angie. You know, because at the time he was doing a lot of writing for Trina. So
okay.
He was noted for that, so they brought him in. And that's when I met him. He had a cast on his foot at the time. His foot was broke or something. And we met, and I thought he was real talented. And you know, we exchanged numbers, and I started sending him beats from then on. And at the time, he had this girl named Ashley Ross, actually, that he was working with. She sounded dope. And I don't know what happened to her. Like, somebody need to find her. But yeah, Ashley Ross, and we started, you know, keeping in contact. And maybe like a year and a half, 2 years later, he came out with Hustler. You know, he came out to Jersey, you know, to my career probably like 2 or 3 times. Stayed, probably got like 10 records, like 10, 15 records at the house that we never put out before. But yeah, I always knew he had it. And that's why he had where he at today. He still got it.
Okay. Now, I know that there was some tension between you and Justice League. Is that water under the bridge, or is there still, you know, something there about the name?
I mean, no, it's definitely won't need the bridge, but at the same time, you know, this is a business that we all in, and this is how I feed my family. So, as far as my craft, I take my craft seriously. You know, what I'm saying, I'm passionate about what I do. So anything that conflicts with that, of course, I have an issue with, whether that be Justice League or whoever. But at the same time, it's like, you know, that's my main concern, is just protecting my brand and make sure nobody's turning, you know, running away with my brand. So at the end of the day, no, I have no problem with Justice League at all. You know, we have hashed out what we need to hash out. Everything is cool, moving forward. Me and Rook talk on Instagram sometime. Everything is love.
What's the craziest story that you can tell on camera that you had with an artist?
I remember working with Coogee Rap and banging out something for him on the spot. We were working at Soundtrack Studios in Manhattan, and a friend of mine came to see me. You know, me and G Rap was in the room, a couple of his goons or whatever. And my man came in the room, but I was programming with him at the time, so when he came in, I just spoke and I just kept doing what I was doing. I didn't really address the room or whatever. So he came in, He walked back out, and maybe probably like 20, 30 minutes later, I just see these big four, big dudes just walking in the room, and I'm like, G-Rap, like, yo, I'm gonna holler at you for a minute. I'm like, what's going on? He's like, yo, what's up with your people? They came in, they ain't speak, everything all right? And I'm like, yeah, everything's fine. You know what I'm saying? Like, everything is beautiful. He's like, yo, I just wanna make sure, you know? I'm like, you know, because, you know, your man came in, they speak, you know? And I was just like, whoa. That's when I was just like, okay, you just got to really acknowledge who you're working with, you know, at all times. Everybody don't take certain things, you know, serious. But when you, somebody like G-Rap, the straight from the street, you know, I knew that, you know, I knew better, but at the same time, I didn't pay any mind. I was caught up on what I was doing. But at the same time, yes, you know, most of the guys who come in and don't speak and act shady, that's the one that's going to rob you. So, right. You know what I'm saying? So, of course, he brought it to his attention, and you know, he definitely, you know, pulled out a card about like, yo, everything all right? Do we need to have a conversation right now? So you know, it was all good, though.
Did that song come out?
Yeah, it's a record I did with him and Prodigy. It Ain't Where You From, It's Where You At.
Okay.
Yeah, Prodigy from Mobb Deep. All
right. On 1-900 Hustler, mm-hmm. that interlude, that not the interlude, but the elevator music, mm-hmm. was that already in the...
No, that's my man O'Shea. My man O'Shea just played something right quick.
That's crazy.
But it was nothing structured, you know what I'm saying? Just something right quick.
How'd that even come about?
1-900 Hustler had been coming together for months. You know what I'm saying? They had the beat for months, but didn't really know how to approach it. Well, they knew they wanted to use it. So, you know, it took a long time for people to figure out, okay, well, how are we going to tackle this joint? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, shit is crazy, but we just can't really wrap our head around it. So finally, Jay came with the idea of just doing either Jay or Bean. I think it was one of the two came with the idea of doing just a 1-900 call-in idea. And then I just started coming up with stuff to do in between, you know what I'm saying, to make it feel like an actual call-in, you know what I'm saying, service. So that's how I came about. And that's actually me at the end of Murder, Death, Kill, Homicide that people didn't know.
Are you part of Detox? Are you going to be?
Oh. I hope so. You know what I'm saying? Listen, like, I tilt my hat to Dre. You know what I'm saying? It's one of my, you know, all-time favorites, you know, in the game. You know, for a lot of reasons. But I would love to be a part of that. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm sure that, you know, it's going to mark a milestone, you know, if and when this album ever drops. You know what I'm saying? He has so much work, so much body of work he's already done for it. So to go back through all that stuff he's recorded and actually make it to the album, it should be a big deal because there's so many songs to pick from, you know? So, you know, and it's all top-notch producers. It's not no, like, the list ain't a punk at all, like, you got some serious names on this list. So it'll be interesting to see.
Now, I know how I submit beats to artists. Like, how does Bink, you know, get work or submit beats to artists? Do you call the A&R of, or do you just speak with the artist directly?
I mean, it's a case-by-case situation, depending on your relationship. You know, who you got it with. The people you don't have a relationship with, then you're forced to go through the A&Rs. But the people you have relationships with, then you're fortunate enough to have, you know, a cell phone or something, an email of some sort to just, you know, hey, listen, check this out, it's time, let me know, type of thing. So that's pretty much what I do. I mean, email something and say, yo, check your email, let me know. And just, you know, go back and forth like that.
Well, why do you think you're so underrated? You're like the underrated big guy in the industry. Like, you have hits, but, you know, people, you know, underestimate you. They don't talk about you.
I mean, for one, I don't have a tag on my beats, for one. And for two, I've never really been a stunner. You know what I'm saying? I've never really been out here with the whole stunt game. You know, I've always been, you know, well, if you know, you don't. It's all good. It never really bothered me, you know, so... I think that has a lot to do with it. Now actually going out of my way to brand myself. So that's why I'm probably underrated or what have you, but the work is there.
what made you go reggae for the Ross record?
That Ross record is old, bro. Like, the beat I had done a while ago. That was on the same beat CD as Devil New Dress stuff. You know what I'm saying? So, that's how long it had been circulating. You know what I'm saying? But somebody finally figured it out, I guess.
Was Devil in the New Dress, was that originally going to be a Ross record and then Kanye heard it?
No. It was just that, you know, everybody had access to it, you know, at that time. And Kanye is the one who acted on it, you know, aggressively. You know what I'm saying? Expeditiously, as Joe Plot would say. You know what I'm saying? So he knocked it out real quick. So it was dope. He went to the, you know, it went to the best place, I believe.
Okay. Yeah, I believe so, too. That beats bananas.
We redid the You, Me, Him, and Her beat from Dynasty recently with, the artist from the guy who's playing The Wire. Mac Wiles.
Oh, okay.
We redid that. Me and my man, Alan Ritter.
Yeah. This the best song on it.
Hello?
Yeah.
My phone is fucking home. Can you hear me?
Hello?
Yo. This damn phone.
Are you going to meet you?
By the ferry.
Downtown?
Yeah.
Alright.
Come on.
I'm not going to leave you back in the morning.
I mean, I can't. You coming too? We can take it back in my crib.
So did Salam come to you and say, yo, we want to redo?
Absolutely. Salam actually called me and said, would you happen to still have the disc from it? I was like, actually, I do. So that's why I pulled the MP out.
Wow.
And I still got the floppy disc from back then. I loaded up the original floppy. It still worked. And load up the session again. And then send it to my man Alan. Threw the keys on it. Good deal.
It worked.
It worked out.
When you do a beat, when you're done, do you have an artist in mind? Like, yo, Redman would sound good on this. Oh, yo, like Styles P would kill this.
Oh, definitely. But you know, anybody will tell you, no, I got the best mumble flow from this side of the Hudson. You know what I'm saying? My mumble flow is serious. Nobody wants to see me with the mumble flow. Like, if I could put words to what I'm mumbling. This is a problem. Trust me. Ask around. They'll tell you. Bink mumble flow. Mumble flow game is serious. Trump type. But yeah, so I know how to mimic people's flow. You know what I'm saying? Whoever. Yeah. Wale, Ross, Kanye, you name it. Drake. I know everybody's cadence.
Any up-and-coming artists that you wouldn't mind working with? Like, who's buzzing out there, but, you know, not really signed to nobody?
It's this girl named 390. It's dope. I know her. She probably gonna punch me in the chest when she see me. I supposed to have been sent her or something. But she's dope. Like, that's one of the dopest female MCs I heard in a long time.
She from here?
No, she's from New Orleans.
Okay.
But she's tight. What's the, I like those kids, COD from Philly. They on some different, like, they definitely doing something different. Like, they got a real live feel to them. Like, they understand music, I can tell. I can't really think, I'm drawing a blank right now as far as new up and coming people that I want to work with. that I don't know already. You know, I can't really, I can't really think right now, to be honest with you.
Yo, I saw one thing that I left out about your discography. You did a joint with Chuck Brown.
On his birthday.
How the hell did that come about?
Chucky Thompson.
Okay.
My OG. My big homie Chucky invited me out to D.C. a few years ago, probably about 5 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago. And we knocked on a few things. He's working with this girl at the time, I forgot her name. This white girl played guitar, she was dope. But yeah, and Chuck Brown came through. I was just dumb geek. You know what I'm saying? I grew up on Chuck, so to be in the same room with him and to actually have a chance to ask Mr. Brown like what made him come up with Go Go. And for him to give me an answer, it was like I just felt like he gave me the holy grail. You know what I'm saying? It's something that he invented, and it was just like such a blessing and an honor. To hear him tell me that himself on his birthday actually, and I just remember saying to myself like, "Yo, I hope I look like that at that age," because like he still had some cut to his arm, and you know what I'm saying, like.
Yeah.
Then they say Chuck used to box, you know what I'm saying, before, and yeah, so he said that he used to be in a couple band, and he noticed that when they would break the music down, that the people would party even more harder. So he said he just came up with just one long breakdown. That's pretty much what he was saying with his music was. And I was just like, that's genius. When you think about it, people go crazy on the breakdown of Before I Let Go. You know what I'm saying? Brick House. You know what I'm saying? Like, all the classic joints, you know, Funky Jamaica, when they get to that breakdown, though, it's just DJs automatically cut right to that part. You know what I'm saying? So it's like he just became up. He just kept doing a whole bunch of those sections. Just one long one. The whole record would be that. So that's why Go-Go had the energy that it had. Or has. So yeah, it was dope doing that with him. Love Nationwide was the name of the record.
Okay. Can you play like two more joints for us? And have you ever done work with Busta?
Yeah, I did some on that Dragon mixtape called God dang it, what was it? Shake it. Some shaking, man. I can't even think of it, bro. But let me see. See, everybody know me for just a whole bunch of loud horn stuff or whatever.
Yeah, horns and drums.
Did you hear the Stack Quo record?
Somebody tweeted me. I have not heard the Stack Quo record. I heard it's hot right now, though. He making a comeback?
Yeah. And we did it. You know, we did the record together. This one.
These young guys, I don't recognize them. Big body, they don't exist.
Carlito, man, that valley out here, man. You know, me. I take to the street with any of these motherfuckers, man. But these new kids nowadays, man, they got no respect for human life. They shotgun you, man, just to see you fly up in the air, man, church, and you better off from jail.
I'm just gonna get my coffers on. Turn me up, boy. Follow the plug, my nigga.
Think I can't help but to kill niggas. Bunch of pussy-ass rappers, they ain't real niggas. I'm trying to find balance. Why the hiatus? That's what the fans ask, but on my quest to be the greatest, I'm like, why ball if you playing for the Raiders? Surrounded by traitors, we all trying to eat, but somebody gotta cater, somebody gotta waiter. That's just life, Bugatti or a bike. Long as I get there, my health's alright. My nigga feeling good about life, yeah. So I return like hot dice in a crap game. Almost lost my mind to this rap thing. Put the flame to the cush, smoke to the brain. Since my dad died, a nigga ain't been the same. He's still alive, but fuck it, y'all hear me, man. He's still alive, but fuck it, y'all hear me, man. Now I'm flirting with this bitch on the plane. Told me her favorite rapper was Raw, Drizzy, and Wayne. I'm like, that's what's up, but when we gon' fuck? Come to find out she fucked all them niggas. I used to love her like karma, but my passion's slipping. At the end of the day, you can't trust these bitches.
You don't tell a lot of people.
It's gonna be on a new album?
No, it's on the EP now, iTunes. Go to iTunes, download that. It's called That's Life. Stack Whoa.
Somebody did something to that already? Who do you envision on that track? With the mumbling? Oh?
Kiss. It's supposed to go to Kiss. But then some DJ from Atlanta leaked it. I'm not going to say his name because we'll further promote him. That's not what I'm trying to do.
Now, how do you like the MPC Renaissance over the ASR-10?
I mean, for one, that's not even fair to ask.
Yeah.
You know, just on the defense of the ASR. But just because of the simple fact that, you know, this has USB now. You know what I'm saying? If you were to add USB to the ASR-10, I'm sure it would give it a little edge, but the sequencing is just so much better in here. Which is dope, but the output on the ASR is dope too. A lot of people sleep on, don't really know too much about, but it's dope. But the Renaissance is definitely, you know, this is what you want. If you're from the MP world, like, this will keep you from having to have a learning curve trying to learn Logic or Fruity Loops or any other software. Like, this will keep you where you already are with the addition of the new stuff.
Since my dad died, a nigga ain't been the same. He's still alive, but fuck it, y'all hear me, man. He's still alive, but fuck it, y'all hear me, man. Now I'm flirting with this bitch on the plane. Told me her favorite rappers was Raw, Drizzy, and Wayne. I'm like, that's what's up.